Hello and welcome to India's World. Today we are discussing French President François Hollande's visit to India. He'll be here for 2 days on February 14th and 15th. The question we are asking is, has India-France relationship fallen short of its potential? And to discuss this issue with me, I have a distinguished panel of experts. I have Mr. Frédéric Bobin from the formidable French newspaper Le Monde, Ambassador Kamal Sibal, an amazing diplomat who's been Foreign Secretary of India, as well as a very successful ambassador of India to France, and my old friend Vijay Singh, who's a distinguished filmmaker and a journalist based in Paris. So welcome all of you to the show. Frédéric, let me begin with you. What are the French expectations from this visit? What are the deliverables that the French would be hoping for?
Well, if you look at this visit on the trade perspective, for example, of course, there are some big ticket deals which are in the tune. You know, for example, the Rafale, the multi-role combat aircraft. Rafale has been selected. Some exclusive negotiations are going on, but the contract has not yet been formally signed. So, of course, the French side is waiting for the formal signature. There is also the nuclear, the civilian nuclear cooperation. France has to propose two, EPR nuclear reactor to India, and also
EPR is European pressurized reactors.
Yes, yes. Yeah. Also in this regard, the negotiation is still going on. But you know, the problem is that the French approach of India is too much focus on big deal tickets, and that's the major handicap of France compared to Germany, for example.
Okay, Vijay, let me ask you this. Nicolas Sarkozy was a flamboyant person, okay? The new president, François Hollande, is not a flamboyant person. Some say he's very practical and even predictable. So as an expat living in Paris, what do you expect from his visit?
Well, not just that. I can give you a first-hand experience of what François Hollande looks like. Mm-hmm. I was invited a couple of months ago to Élysée. He gave a wonderful speech. He was very warm. I had been to Sarkozy's thing also. So I think it's a bit of a media misrepresentation at times to think that, you know, Hollande is. Because Hollande is one of those people who people didn't expect that he'll become the president. And when he became the president, he started going up. Obviously, there are economic problems and rates of popularity of, you know, many a president fall. But I personally think that he's someone who is going to consolidate after being here. But just to come back to the issue that you were talking about, for the last 7-8 years, there's an awareness in France today, because they've woken up to this market called India. There's an awareness today that our attitude towards India has been, you know, inductionist. You go there, you pick up Dulhasti. You go there, you pick up Alcatel. Whereas you have to be sort of across the spectrum. You have to spread out in this market, and that's what they're looking for. And not just the eco-technological, it is education, you know.
Okay. Ambassador Sibal, let me ask you a slightly different question. Mm-hmm. See, one of the reasons why India found France attractive to deal with was because France was not America. France was not like the rest. France had an independent foreign policy. But isn't that changing now? I mean, France is doing the same that America wants it to do in Libya, in Syria. They're aggressive about Iran. They're actually militarily intervening in Mali. So where is the meeting ground in international relations in dealing with France today?
Well, there are two aspects. One is our bilateral relationship and the strategic aspects of it. I think on that there's good understanding. The contract, Rafale contract, will not be signed when President Hollande comes here. But that's understood, because our practice is not to sign such big defense contracts during a high-level visit. They're signed either before or after. Yeah. Because if we begin this practice of doing that, then pressures build up, you know, to do something. And that short circuits the processing and everything else. On the nuclear thing, and I'll come back to your question, on the nuclear thing, I think the safety aspects have been clarified and satisfactorily. But the issue remains price and the tariff. The tariff, to my mind, what I know, the tariff is reasonable. I think we would want them to reduce it further.
We will come to the nuclear issue and discuss it
later. But insofar as the international aspect is concerned, Yes, there are differences of thinking with regard to French policy on Libya, on Iran, and on Syria. Okay. But I don't think this has become a contentious issue between the two countries. I think the French side accepts that we have a different view, and we leave it at that. In any case, this is France is part of the general Western policy towards these countries, and to the extent that earlier on France differentiated itself from NATO policies or US policies yeah. on Iraq, for example, that did actually have a very favorable echo in India.
Absolutely.
Because France was looked upon as somebody who was non-aligned, in inverted commas, in the Western camp.
Or another pillar in a multipolar world, you know? I mean, otherwise you had America, China, but France was the third pillar.
Not really in the, it's not a third pillar, but we always say the European Union is the third pillar. But France, you know, we were able to empathize with France because we could understand each other. But now with the French policies with regard to these countries, there is a gap in terms of how the two countries appreciate these things. And I think the other issue which is connected to this is what is French policy towards the rise of Islamic extremism?
I'll come to that. We'll come to that. Frederick, tell me, why is France in Mali? I mean, you, the ostensible reason is that you're countering Al-Qaeda, but Al-Qaeda is one of the four elements there. There is a freedom movement going on there. There is local jihadis. So three out of four are local homegrown movements. Yet France cites Chapter 51 of UN and acts as if a foreign country had invaded Mali. Mali has asked us, ECOWAS has asked us, and therefore we're going there and the world keeps quiet. Why are you in Mali?
First of all, I think that the Malian government asked for it, and some neighboring
true, but you don't have to go.
Neighboring African countries also were asking France to do something. Yeah. The key point was when these forces, the rebel forces, which were in a first stage based on the northern part of Mali, started to move southern part to the south, and the risk was very high that they could took over. They could take over actually Bamako, the capital. And let's say if a sort of, you know, a jihadist movement had taken over Bamako, that could have, you know, be a quite a dangerous development for the whole, you know, this part of the world. Okay. So actually, that's the rationale. Now, people can challenge that, can dispute the legitimacy of the French intervention, but the rationale was to prevent an extremist movement from taking over Mali.
Okay. At that point, we need to take a break. We'll continue with this interesting discussion. Don't go away. Keep watching Rajya Sabha TV. Welcome back. We are discussing Indo-French relations. Before we went on the break, we were discussing why France is in Mali. Vijay, let me ask you this. Is France in Mali because it wants to help the government there, or is it there because it doesn't want the disturbances to spill over into Niger, where it has lot of interest in uranium mining?
I think it's
you recall that Ariba officials were kidnapped by jihadists there, and there are allegations that the French actually paid huge amount of ransom, and it's that money which has helped the jihadists modernize.
Yeah. That's what the US ambassador says, but I think there's an element of truth in all the different three factors you mentioned. You know, the four elements you're mentioning within Mali, I think, to be fair to the French, Al-Qaeda is probably the strongest among them. It wasn't just in Mali. Over the last 4 or 5 months, it's been, you know, that capture of Timbuktu, capture of several mosques over there, and their spread. You know, there are several factors which are connecting into the French Islamophobia within quotes
all
today.
All issues internal to Mali.
All issues internal to France as well. France, to Mali, to Eastern Africa, to the piracy going on in the seas, to Syria. I mean, there is a whole, ever since this Arab printemps.
That's a point of view which I don't share, but we'll leave it at that.
No, what I'm saying is that it's all, I'm trying to explain the attitude.
You can explain it, but I'm saying once you support this kind of intervention in the internal affairs of another country,
where does it stop?
It has implications. But Ambassador Sybil, now that this has happened, you know, France was the first country we signed a strategic partnership with, so we should have developed a common strategic vision. Now, after French policies in West Africa, and after this intervention in Mali, which incidentally we haven't opposed, what are the prospects of developing such a strategic vision, a common vision?
Well, coming back to Mali, I think the French kept us informed in advance. of what was happening in Mali, and they were very pleased that we co-sponsored one of their resolutions in the UN Security Council. So on that, I don't think there's any gap in understanding, though one can make the point that part of the reason why there is this problem in Mali is because of the intervention in Libya. Yeah.
It's a blowback from Libya.
It's a blowback from Libya. Therefore, was the West wise in intervening in Libya as they did? That question can always be discussed and raised and discussed. Insofar as the gap in strategic vision is concerned, I think with regard to what's happening in the Arab world and the intervention of the West in these countries, the outreach towards the Muslim Brotherhood, and because of that, inevitably to the Salafists, and then connected to that is the whole issue of how to deal with Islamic extremism and terrorism. On that, I think we need to develop a better understanding with the French in terms of what is happening on the ground now. But then there are other large parts of the world where we have good understanding, whether it is the Indian Ocean, whether it is in our region, immediate region, yeah. Pakistan, Afghanistan, and the issue of terrorism there, or the South China Sea, yeah. And the rise of China, although we don't talk about it too much publicly, but I think that on the French side, yeah. And on the Indian side, there are shared concerns about some aspects, okay. Of the consequences of China's, okay. China's rise. So there is, and then of course there is a question of which we'll probably discuss later on the bilateral level.
We'll come to that.
How the two countries can reinforce each other, yeah. To be able to deal with the global problems, okay. In more effectively. Okay.
Frederick, one of the important collaborations with France is the civilian nuclear power collaboration. After Fukushima, even in India, there have been protests against nuclear power. In Kudankulam, we've seen massive protests. In Jetapur, in Ratnagiri district of Maharashtra, where the Areva plants are to be set up, there are also protests there. Do you think the French would be able to work with these protests? Do you think they expect the Maharashtra government and the Indian government to deal with these protesters? And then they just move in with their reactors? Would it be easy?
Well, actually, it's not the business of France, you know, to fix the issue of security, or it's the business of India, you know, whether it's the central government or the Maharashtra. So I think France would like Indian side to convince the local population that it's safe. You know? Yeah. Personally, I went to Jaitapur, to Ratnagiri. I talked to the villagers, and that's something that I would like my leaders to do as well, because it's quite interesting to talk directly to the concerned people. And I was struck to see that there is a big fear, and that, yeah. was in the aftermath of Fukushima, so yeah. There was sort of, you know, very negative atmosphere, yeah. As far as the nuclear is concerned. But I don't expect the French officials to go to Jaitapur and to talk directly, yeah. To the villagers. That's not their business.
Yeah, yeah. Point taken. But Vijay, let me ask you. You live in Paris. Now you tell me that in France, I mean, the safety record of French nuclear industry is pretty good, actually. But at the same time, the Socialist Party has said that they would phase out old reactors. 25 reactors are to be phased out. The first one, I think, is at Fessenheim, which will be phased out by 2017. And by 2050, France wants to reduce its dependence on nuclear energy. So you have one standard for France and quite another of promoting nuclear energy elsewhere.
Look, I really don't know, because I don't see it happening. Because I, as you say, that I know France. Our dependence on nuclear energy, use of energy produced through nuclear means, I don't see this going anywhere unless, you know, there are five Fukushimas in the 10 years to come.
Well,
and
this kind of, let's hope not,
but if these things, I mean, I'd be very happy that if these electrical promises could be, you know, fulfilled, and yeah. We could get out of, or we could find a balance, okay. Between, okay. Some, but I personally think that it's going to be very difficult.
Okay. Sybil, do you think France will be able to work within the framework of the Nuclear Liability Act? Because the US is opposed to the provisions of the act, because they don't want manufacturers' liability. The Russians also don't want it. They copy the Americans. They take the cue from there. What about the French? Is the French position any different?
Yes. I think I have it on good authority that the French are willing to work under the rules, and the rules which have been drafted under the Nuclear Liability Act, because those are much more flexible. Yes. And I don't think that is really a make or break issue so far as the French are concerned. The make or break issue is the tariff issue, at what tariff the price at electricity would actually be produced.
Yeah.
And the Indian side would want the tariff to be as close to the Kudankulam tariff, which probably will be difficult for the French side to...
Why? Because the costs have gone up because of safety requirements?
Yes, but the Coudenculum plants were built many... Actually, the agreement was signed many years ago.
Okay.
Since then, naturally, prices have increased everywhere. And number two, Coudenculum 3 and 4, which have been decided now, I think there's good reason for the French to argue that the same kind of calculation or costs cannot be transferred to
French. I need to take a break at this moment. We'll be back soon. Don't go away. Keep watching Rajya Sabha TV. Welcome back. We are discussing how Indo-French relations can realize their full potential. Before we went on the break, Ambassador Sibal, you were comparing Jetapur with Coudenculum. But while you do that, I would also like you to tell me where do the French stand on dual-use technologies?
Yeah, but just very, very briefly on the Coudenculum 3 and 4, because Coudenculum 3 and 4 are a continuation of Coudenculum 1 and 2. Therefore, a lot of costs have been amortized.
Okay.
But the EPR reactors are new ones.
Okay, fine.
So therefore, you can't really compare.
You can't compare. It's not
insofar as dual technology issue is concerned, I think it is safe to say...
That is dual technology that can have civilian as well as defense use.
Absolutely.
And you are prevented from getting it because you are not a member of Nuclear Suppliers Group, the Vasna Arrangement, Australia Group, and the Missile Technology Control Regime.
Yes.
So therefore, if you're not a member of these arrangements, you don't get that technology.
No, even if you're a member of these, still you won't get it.
Okay.
Because we've been told time and again, the membership of these groups does not give you any entitlements.
But where do the French stand vis-a-vis?
But in fact, you will have obligations to make sure that none of these things are passed on to anybody else. So that's not going to get us technology relating to missiles, military missiles, or nuclear issues, etc., etc. But let me say with confidence that leaving aside Russia, I think amongst the Western countries, the French are the most liberal and flexible with regard to dual technology use.
So we'll get dual use technology?
We will get dual use technology up to a point, because certain technologies which are directly related and are critical insofar as nuclear weapon technology or missile technology is concerned, I don't think France or anybody else would give it to us because they will be violating their own international obligations. But where there are gray areas and where actually the technology is meant for civilian use, but there is a fear it might be used for military purposes, there I think there is a sense of confidence and that can be developed where we can get some of these things from the French, I think.
Okay, Vijay, how crucial is the Indo-French defense relationship and clinching the Rafale deal? What impact would it have on that relationship?
Well, first of all, you know, France has been looking for a presence in India. If Rafale goes through, then I was talking to someone who's very close to these things. He says this is guaranteed that for the next 30 to 40 years, the French are here in this field. Because, you know, the way we talk about from our childhood, we've heard of these words called MiG-21 and MiG-25. Same way, you're going to hear about Rafale for the next 30 years because it's going to carry on, there's replenishments, there's accessories, industry will grow laterally, you know, vertically. So I think this is a huge thing for France. But again, as I said before, that the real relationship between technological or trade between the two countries can be when it is at B2B, you know, business to business level across the thing. We have perhaps also to think that culture, cinema, and education are two great domains. France invests 3,000 crores every year of state money that goes here in entertainment tax. We don't even see a penny of it, right? France reinvests that all into cinema, right? And I think we have a lot to learn here if there's collaboration between.
Frederick, let me ask you about trade and investment. The Eurozone crisis, will it affect French investment in India or Indian investment in France? After all, India is the 13th largest job creator in France. I'm surprised to read that. You think the Eurozone crisis will impact
course,
it or it's already
of course.
Over?
You see Peugeot, the automaker Peugeot, were supposed to launch a factory in Gujarat. And it's suspended, you know, because Peugeot is running into financial troubles. So, of course, that the crisis is impacting the dynamic of the French investment, not only in India, but, you know, abroad in general.
Okay. Mr. Sibal, I want to ask you something. You know, you would expect that in a free market, you let people, you know, who live by the market, die by the market. You take the case of Mittal in France. You know, the entire weight of the government was sort of brought down on Mr. Lakshmi Mittal. And he was told that, look, you cannot close down a couple of blast furnaces. Mm-hmm. And if you do, we're going to nationalize you or we're going to throw you out. Now, you can't have free market economy and also have this kind of firm-level, company-level intervention. You leave it to trade unions.
Right. Well, you know, this
what signal does it send to other Indian companies?
No, I think the Anglo-Saxons are also targeting France constantly because of its labor laws and its very restrictive legislation with regard to labor in general, which is why the French don't raise this subject of labor reforms in India with us with the same degree of force as the Americans.
Only 650 jobs were being lost. Yeah.
I know.
So this is a problem in certainly in France. In fact, Premji has just said that unless there is reform of the French labor legislation, you're not going to invest a penny in France.
Okay,
so it's a disincentive. It's a disincentive. But on the other hand, I think there's a statistic which I just got to know, which is important, that the French have done an internal exercise to find out how much actually the French have invested in India, not directly from France itself, but through Mauritius, through Singapore, whatever else, is $17 billion. Yeah. Whereas the official figure is 3.5.
How much is it? Sorry?
$17
billion. $17
billion. Although the official figure is only 3.5. So there's very considerable French investment. A lot of R&D is taking place.
But $12 billion was the figure that Sarkozy quoted when he came here, that by 2012,
That's the trade. Oh, that's the trade. It's only $8 billion, so they have not reached that figure at all.
Okay, so we're reaching the end of the program. So I want all of you to quickly tell me what needs to be done so that Indo-French relations reach their required potential.
I think there's a vast potential between the two countries for something which you mentioned earlier. Their profiles are the same. France is always... In France, money has not been a very, wonderful thing, right? Like in America. So France has had this certain independence vis-a-vis the world, and India has had it vis-a-vis the third world, so the two can come together, number one. Number two,
quickly,
I think that
because
they need to
everyone.
Explore many avenues, which include cinema, education, as I said, and I think there
as
is...
As a filmmaker, he agitates about cinema. Frederick, what do you think?
No, I think that's what I mentioned at the very beginning. We have to shift from this habit of, you know, signing big deal tickets, and we have to go to to try to interest, you know, smaller size and medium size, you know, enterprises. And for that, I mean, you have to be patient.
Okay.
Because
Ambassador Sybil,
I would say that we should not be cynical about Europe. I find cynicism here as if the only countries that matter are the United States and maybe now China or whatever else. And Europe, you know, there is a kind of a attitude towards Europe that Europe doesn't matter anymore. This is a very wrong view of Europe. And that should change, and therefore we should be much more open. And within Europe, I think France can be a privileged partner, along with Britain and Germany.
We've run out of time. I thank all of you for sharing your views with me and educating our viewers about Indo-French relations. That's all we have for today. We'll be back again next week with another issue. Till then, goodbye.